Hi friends, today I am going to discuss about iodimetry and iodometry, means redox titration. Okay, both are redox titration only. Before going to discuss about iodimetry and iodometry, first we should know about what is mean by reducing agent. First, what is mean by oxidizing agent? Let's see. Reducing agent means a reactant which loses electrons in redox reaction and itself it oxidized is known as reducing agent. See, a reactant which loses electrons in redox reaction and itself oxidized is known as reducing agent. Means it means, see, it is ready to lose the electrons in redox reaction. Here losing of electrons which is known as oxidation process. So after losing electrons itself, it will be oxidized. It is known as reducing agent. See, reducing agent helps to reduce the other substances. Means after losing electrons, here these electrons will be gained by other substances. After electrons gained by other substances, other will undergo reduction. Gaining of electrons, which is known as reduction. That's why it helps to reduce the other substances. Okay, the example of reducing agent: sodium thiosulfate, stannous chloride, antimony trioxide, ferrous sulfate, oxalic acid. All these are example of reducing agent. Means all these are able to lose electrons in redox reaction. All these are able to undergo oxidation process in redox titration. Okay, then coming to oxidizing agent, a reactant which gains electrons in redox reaction, and itself it reduced is known as oxidizing agent. See, oxidizing agent means it is able to gain the electrons in redox reaction. A reactant which gains electrons in redox reaction and itself is reduced means gaining of electrons, it is nothing but reduction only. So it is known as oxidizing agent. Here oxidizing agent helps to oxidize the other substances. Here it will help to oxidize the other substances. Same like reducing agent. Reducing agent helps to reduce the other substances. Oxidizing agent helps to oxidize the other substances. Means here it will oxidize the other substances. After oxidation, electrons will be liberated. These electrons will gain by oxidizing agent and itself it undergoes reduction. Right? The example of oxidizing agent. KMnO4, potassium dichromate, KaO3, and potassium bromate, and serial ammonium sulfate. Potassium permanganate, potassium dichromate, potassium iodide, potassium bromate, serial ammonium sulfate are example of oxidizing agent. Means all these compounds gain electrons in redox titration. All these will undergo reduction process only. Undergoing reduction. See, for standardization of here. For in redox titration, both reducing agent and oxidizing agents are very necessary. In redox titration, both oxidation and reduction will occur simultaneously. One compound undergoes reduction, other will undergoes oxidation. Okay, for determination of first standardization of oxidizing agent, we will use reducing agent. For standardization of reducing agent, we will use oxidizing agent. Let's see, KMnO4, it is known as oxidizing agent, right? It can be determined, it can be standardized by using oxalic acid. KMnO4 is a oxidizing agent. It can be standardized by using oxalic acid. Here oxalic acid is a reducing agent. So likewise, sodium thiosulfate, which is known as reducing agent. Sodium thiosulfate is standardized by using potassium iodide. Potassium iodide is an example of oxidizing agent only. See, it is like same example, same as like in acid-based titration. See, for HCl and H2SO4, for both are acid, we know that. For determination of these acidic compounds, for standardization of these acidic compounds, we have to use sodium carbonate. For standardization of HCl or for standardization of H2SO4, it is done by using sodium carbonate. Sodium carbonate is in basic nature. HCl and H2SO4 are in acidic nature. So acidic compound determination is done by basic compounds. See, likewise, if you see sodium hydroxide, it is a basic nature. Sodium hydroxide standardization is done by oxalic acid. See, this is acidic form, basic form. Same concept is applicable in redox titration. Okay. Then coming to iodimetry and iodometry. Iodometry, see, in which iodine is liberated. Sorry, first iodometry and iodometry. iodometry and iodometry. See, both are redox titration which are involved in determination of iodine. Both iodometry and iodometry are redox titration which involved in determination of iodine only. Based on the determination of iodine, it is having small variation. See, iodometry involves direct determination of iodine. Iodometry involves indirect determination of iodine. That is the basic difference between iodometry and iodometry. Iodometry involves direct determination of iodine. Iodo means indirect determination. Both are involved in determination only. But iod means direct determination. Iodo means indirect determination of iodine. Okay, let's see what is the principle involved in iodometry and iodometry. Before going to principle, first we should know how iodine will act. Okay, iodine is a weak oxidant, means weak oxidizing agent. It will gain the electrons, right? Iodine is a weak oxidant. It is used in the redox titration for the determination of easily oxidized substances, means reduced compounds, for determination of reducing compounds. Iodine is a weak oxidant. It is used in redox titration for determination of easily oxidized substance. Why easily means this is weak, right? Okay, by using iodine, we cannot determine strong reductants. Only we can determine easily oxidized substances. Okay, easily oxidized substances. Only reducing agents only undergoes oxidation. Okay, we can determine by using iodine, we can determine easily oxidized substances. Okay, then iodine reduced by reductants like sodium thiosulfate, stannous chloride, and examples are there. Iodine is reduced by reductants like sodium thiosulfate, stannous chloride, antimony trioxide. All these are example of reductants. Okay. Whenever iodine is reacted with these reductants, what happens? This iodine undergoes reduction. These reductants like Na2CS2O3, stannous chloride will undergo oxidation. Right? Then see what is the principle involved in iodometry. In this, known volume of standard iodine solution taken in a flask and which is titrated directly with reductant using starch as an indicator. See, in this, see, known volume of standard iodine solution. Here, known volume of standard iodine solution we are taking in the flask. Okay, after taking in the flask to the standard iodine solution, we are adding starch as an indicator. In presence of starch as an indicator, this iodine solution is titrated directly with reductant compounds, which is known as iodometry, means direct determination. See how directly we are taking iodine solution, right? That's why it is known as direct determination of iodine. Directly we are taking iodine solution. In iodometry, we will not take indirect. Let's see how iodometry. In this, known volume of standard iodine solution taken in a flask, which is titrated directly with reductant using starch as an indicator. Okay, then endpoint is detected by change of blue color to colorless. How can you determine the endpoint? EP means endpoint. See, whenever starch used an indicator, the color will change it to blue to colorless. Right? Endpoint is detected by change of blue color to colorless. Means initial the solution having blue color. After the endpoint, you will get colorless solution. Blue color changes to colorless solution. Right? See what happened in iodometry. Iodine undergoes reduction to give iodine. In all iodometric titration, this iodine undergoes reduction to give iodine. See, whenever standard iodine solution, right? Whenever this iodine solution is reacted with reactant solution, what happened? This iodine is the oxidizing agent, so it undergoes reduction. Iodine undergoes reduction to give iodine. See, iodine reduction means by gaining electrons converted to iodide. Means whenever reacted with iodine to reductant, iodine gains electrons from reductant, means reducing agent, and converted to iodide ion. This iodine undergoes reduction while this reductant undergoes oxidation, right? This is most important thing. Iodine undergoes reduction to give iodide. This is happened in all iodometric titration. Okay, iodine, 2 moles of 2 electrons and iodide ion reduction process. See, this is about iodometry. Then coming to iodometry. In which in which what happen, iodine is liberated in analytical solution through the oxidation of iodide. Iodine is liberated in analytical solution through the oxidation of iodide. Okay, this liberated iodine is titrated with strong reductant, is called iodometry or indirect titration of iodine. See, in this first we are taking iodide solution, not direct, not iodine form. First iodide solution we are taking in conical glass. After taking iodine, so iodide solution, okay, this iodide converted to iodine due to oxidation process. This iodide form converted to iodine due to oxidation process. Before going for titration, this iodine, this iodide undergoes oxidation to give iodine. Okay, the iodine. Okay, this liberated iodine is titrated with reductant, is called as iodometry and indirect titration of iodine. The here after oxidation iodine is liberated, right? This iodine is titrated with a reductant compound. If you see in iodometry, if you say in iodometry, directly we are taking standard iodine solution in conical flask. Directly we are titrating with reductant. Okay, this is that's why we are calling as direct titration. In iodometry, first iodide form converted to iodine form due to the oxidation. Okay, after oxidation only iodine will be liberated. This liberated iodine is titrated with reductant. That's why indirect titration. Iodometry is known as indirect. By means, here we are not taking directly in iodine form. Okay, iodometry, it is also known as indirect titration of iodine. See how it is happen, how iodide converted to iodine. See, consider that we have strong oxidant like copper sulfate solution in conical flask. Okay, in conical flask we are taking strong oxidant like copper sulfate solution. We are taking copper sulfate solution that acts as a oxidizing agent. To this we are adding excess potassium iodide solution in presence of acid. Okay, to the copper sulfate solution we are adding excess amount of potassium iodide in presence of acid. What happened? I already told you that copper sulfate acts as a oxidizing agent. But what is the importance of oxidizing agent? It will oxidize the other substances. To the copper sulfate solution, we are adding potassium iodide in excess form. What happened? This iodide form undergoes oxidation due to the copper sulfate. Right? Iodide undergoes oxidation to give iodine form. Iodine form. Right? See, this is iodide ion undergoes oxidation. It gives iodide, iodine form. This is happened in iodometry. Why? This is, if you see in iodometry, iodine undergoes reduction to give iodide form. If you see in iodometry, reverse of this one. See, if you see in iodometry, what happened? If you see iodometry, what happened? This iodide form converted to iodine form due to oxidation. This is reverse of what happened in iodometry. Understood? Right? Then, here electrons are liberated due to oxidation of iodine, right? Iodide. Okay, the electrons liberated by iodide ions are accepted by oxidant and get reduced. So in the conical flask, what is there? Copper sulfate is there and excess potassium iodide is there. Due to the presence of copper sulfate, this iodide form converted to iodine form undergoes oxidation. Electrons will liberate, right? Here we discussed that copper sulfate is known as acts as an oxidizing agent. So it means it gains the electrons. So the electrons liberated by iodine ions are accepted by oxidizing agent. Means oxidant means copper sulfate, and itself is reduced. After accepting the electrons, it undergoes reduction only. See, 2 moles of copper, okay, from copper sulfate dissociate to give copper and sulfate ions. This copper gains the electrons and reduces to Cu form, copper form. So plus 2 form, see, 0 form. It means oxidation number is reduced. It means it gaining 2 electrons. Okay, see, iodide ions present in excess, therefore amount of iodine liberated is equivalent to the concentration of oxidant, that is copper sulfate. See, iodide ions present in excess, therefore amount of iodine liberated is equivalent to the concentration of oxidant. See, we are adding excess amount of potassium iodide, right? Excess amount. How can we determine how much iodide is there? How much iodide ions present in the solution? So both are involved in determination of iodine only. So at final we have to determine the amount of iodine present, right? Here, but in this iodine metal, what happened? This iodide form converted to iodine form. Okay, but we are adding excess amount of iodine, right? This iodide ions present in excess. Therefore, amount of iodine liberated is equivalent to the concentration of oxidant of copper sulfate. The amount of iodine liberated, which is equivalent to the concentration of copper sulfate. How? See, for oxidation of iodide to iodine, 2 moles of 2 electrons are liberated, right? This for production of 1 mole of iodine, how many moles of copper are required? 2 moles, right? For production of 1 mole of iodine, how many moles of copper sulfate is required? 2 moles. That's why iodide ions present in excess, therefore amount of iodine is liberated. It is equivalent to the concentration of oxygen, that is copper sulfate. So if you see here, 2 moles of copper sulfate, you will get 2 moles of copper ion. Here you will get iodine. So here 1 mole of iodine, which is equivalent to the 2 moles of copper ion. Okay. 1 mole of iodine produced corresponding to 2 moles of copper ion, copper sulfate. See, 1 mole of iodine, this is produced due to corresponding to 2 moles of iodine. 1 mole of iodine is produced by the for production of 1 mole of iodine, we require 2 moles of copper sulfate, right? 2 moles of copper sulfate. Therefore, by determining the quantity of liberated iodine, we can determine the amount of copper ions. Okay. If you determine the quantity of liberated iodine, if you determine the amount of iodine present in the solution, if you get the idea about amount of iodine present in the solution, we can also determine the amount of copper ions. Why? This amount of iodine, which is equivalent to the concentration of oxidant. Here 2 moles of copper ions equivalent to the iodine. Based on that, we can, if you know the amount of quantity of liberated iodine, by that information, we can determine the amount of copper ions also. See, this is happened in conical flask before going titration. Okay, then this liberated iodine, the amount we can determine, right? The liberated iodine can be determined by titration with standard sodium thiosulfate solution. Here iodine is liberated. Here amount of iodine can be determined by titrating with sodium thiosulfate solution. Okay, sodium thiosulfate solution. See, this is iodine, and after reacting with sodium thiosulfate, what happened? Sodium tetrathionate. Okay, and sodium iodide form is sodium iodide. See, iodine form converted to iodide form. See, happen here. Sodium thiosulfate, which acts as a reducing agent. Reducing agent. What is the importance of reducing agent? Which will oxidize the others. Which will oxidize the other substances. Sodium thiosulfate is a reducing agent. Okay, what is the importance of reducing agent? It will reduce the other substances and it will undergo oxidation. It will reduce the other substances by donating electrons. Here I told you that sodium thiosulfate is a reducing agent. Itself it undergoes oxidation. After oxidation it will donate electrons. The electrons will be gained by reducing agent. Oxidizing agent. I told you that iodine is a weak oxidant. See, iodine, whenever iodine is oxidizing agent reacted with reducing agent, what happened? This iodine oxidizing agent undergoes reduction and converted to iodide form. Conversion of iodine to iodide is reduction process. Gaining 2 electrons and converted to iodide form. Okay, then meanwhile, this sodium thiosulfate undergoes oxidation and converted to sodium tetrathionate. Right, this is the principle involved in iodimetry and iodometry. Then coming to applications of iodimetry and iodometry are various applications of iodimetry. Useful for determination of reductants like stannous chloride, sodium thiosulfate, and useful for determination of phenolazine and acetate salt. And assay of ascorbic acid, assay of dimer capral, assay of sulfur ionment. So by using iodometry, we can determine the strength of reductants, stannous chloride, sodium thiosulfate. See, stannous chloride, sodium thiosulfate. What happened? Why iodometry we are determining strength of reductants? See, in iodometry directly we are taking iodine, okay, iodine solution, known volume of iodine solution. That known volume is titrated with reductant solution. Okay, that's why we can determine the strength of reductant. Stannous chloride, sodium thiosulfate examples. Then analgene acetazol. Analgene, which is an example of painkiller. Acetazol, which is an example of anti-infective agent, anti-infective component. Say SA of ascorbic acid and SA of dimercaprol, SA of sulfur ointment. While performing the SA of ascorbic acid, here we use iodine only. Ascorbic acid, dimercaprol, sulfur ointment. See, then various applications of iodometry, iodo. See, first in the conical flask, see, copper sulfate, first iodide form converted to iodine form in iodometry. What happened? Iodide form converted to iodine form in iodometry means by oxidation. By oxidation, it will occur in the presence of copper sulfate, means oxidizing agent. See, copper sulfate. See, if you see here, determination of KMnO4, determination of KMnO4, determination of potassium decrement, determination of KO3, determination of copper sulfate and copper acetate. If you see KMnO4, potassium decrement, potassium iodide, copper sulfate, all these are example of oxidizing agent. If you see here, reductant, here iodometry for reductant, here oxidizing agent, okay, and determination of hydrogen peroxide and determination of chlorine in hypochlorites. Determination of thyroxine in thyroid gland and determination of ferric ammonium citrate. Here determination of thyroxine in thyroid gland, which is most important application of iodometry. Thyroxine in thyroid gland. Okay, this is the concept involved in iodometry and iodometry. Thank you for watching.